I'm Brother Taylor Lindeman, pastor at First Baptist Church in Brooklyn, Mississippi. We're so glad you joined us online today for this sermon. You can find additional sermons at these online sources. I hope that the sermon today speaks to you, and we pray that God will move through it.
You might have noticed by the name on the screen that Marietta is not with us this morning, and we are very thankful for Isaiah. From what I understand, you've only been playing for a year, right? Only 1 year. He's 17 years old, and he did marvelous this morning. So make sure you encourage Isaiah this morning. Open your Bibles with me to 1 Corinthians chapter number 8. As we consider the first three verses this morning, 1 Corinthians chapter 8, we're going to be looking at verses 1, 2, and 3 in a sermon entitled Worldly Knowledge and the Loving Knowledge of the Lord. From Brother Clay's scripture that he read this morning out of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it has been some time since I have preached through. We've taken Corinthians a little differently than I took James or Joel or any of the other books that we've walked through. And then I've bitten off little chunks at a time, and we'll look at chapter 8 in the next three sermons together before we pause for a few other things. But Brother Clay read from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, which I probably touched on maybe 2-3 years ago at this point. I have no clue. And we might not have looked at it in some time. But this sermon kind of goes right along with that old sermon, and you can find it on YouTube, and I encourage you to do so, to kind of jive these two thoughts together. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, it looks at the foolishness of the world that thinks they're so wise. But reality is, it is the foolishness of preaching. It is the foolishness of these miracles and the things of God to the world that are true wisdom. And now Paul comes back to that thought now 7-8 chapters later as he looks not this time at the world's knowledge versus the church's knowledge, but the church's knowledge as it relates to the world. Those of us who might think ourselves wise, and bring that into the church. And so it jives right along with that of 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And one thing I need to say before we enter into this is all of chapter 8 is on one big issue in the Corinthian church. Whereas it was sexual sin that was the issue of chapters 5, 6, and 7, now the issue is, what do we do with food that's been sacrificed to idols? This is the question the Corinthian church gives to Paul. And today, Paul sets a groundwork, and you'll see half of verse 1 looks like, hey, this is where we're going. And that's where we're going, but we kind of have to lay some groundwork, and we won't talk much at all about that issue as we go through this morning. And so I want to take the foundation that Paul is laying for his argument. I want to apply it both to that issue in the coming weeks, but also to some issues and some applications that we have in our church and in the world today as we look at what is the purpose of knowledge and how can love inform that. Would you stand with me in the honor of reading God's word as we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. Hear now the words of the living and true God. Now as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth not nothing yet as he ought to know. But if any man love God, the same is known of him. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the knowledge of salvation that is only found in Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we claim to know anything of this world, anything of your word, Lord, I pray that first we would find that we love you most of all and that we recognize above all other truths of this life that it is a firm truth that is unchanging, that you would love us so much that you would lay your life down for us. And Lord, we pray that as we study your word this morning, that the truth and the knowledge of Jesus Christ would be the main thing that penetrates the hearts of each and every person in attendance this morning. And we pray that as we study together, that we would not find ourselves to be wise but fools before an almighty God. Lord, we pray that you'd be with us as we study. Speak to us even now. And we ask this in your son Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated. Paul approaches the question of idol worship, sacrifice to idols, all of these things, by first examining what is knowledge. Verse 1 sets the foundation for the rest of the chapter, in which Paul says, "Now as touching things offered unto idols," and here is the argument beginning, "we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth." When I was young, probably much like you, my mama told me something that was very, very important. From a very, very young age, she said, "Taylor, you stay away from that electrical outlet." Because mama knows a whole lot more than little baby Taylor does. And me, I'm looking over here at the outlet, and I'm like, why? You know, kids like to ask why. Maybe that might be your first word job. It might not be chicken. It might be why. I can tell you from the fifth grade classroom, they love to ask why. And so me, I don't remember exactly how old I am. I might remember, and I'm just too embarrassed to tell you. But I didn't take my mama's advice straight away. And what I did is I decided I might know a little more than mama. I'm going to go and see what's going to happen to me if I stick my finger in that outlet. See, what had happened, I had a desk lamp. And that desk lamp, the light bulb went out. And before they could replace that light bulb, I was sitting over there, and that thing was still plugged in. I said, what's my little finger in this outlet going to do? And I'll tell y'all what. If you ain't never done that before, I got knowledge now. Don't ever do that again. I was electrified. That's why my hair stands up straight. No, I'm joking. So mama told me, don't do it. I didn't listen. I tried it anyway. And, you know, as you get older, maybe there's some electricians in the room. Maybe there's some people who know what real electrical shock looks like. Maybe there's some medical people in the room who know that this is what electric shock can do to the body. You have a whole lot more knowledge on the issue. But at the end of the day, we all have knowledge on this issue. We either have it from mama, we either have it, like the dummy pastor, from experience, or we have it from like a really high level. We all know, don't touch the outlet. To one degree or another, we all have knowledge in this area. And this is the basis that Paul's giving us this morning, is that us as Christians, we all have a degree of knowledge in some of the issues of what it means to follow after Christ. We have a degree of knowledge in what it means to follow the law. We have a degree of knowledge as to how I best should seek out and follow after Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And the more knowledge we get, oftentimes, we find ourselves getting a little bit more, as it says in verse 1, puffed up. And some of us, it doesn't take a whole lot of knowledge at all. Maybe some of us, we have the smallest degree of knowledge, and that knowledge puffs us up to make us think that we know it all. These degrees of knowledge that I have with the electrical outlet and that all of us have as Christians lead us down some different roads. All have the same knowledge. They're just in different degrees sometimes. And here Paul examines the truth of this principle when he says, we know that we all have knowledge. We all have a degree of knowledge. Some of us have a worldly version of knowledge. Some of us have biblical knowledge. Some of us are mature in our knowledge, and some of us are immature in our knowledge. And this truth about knowledge is something that divides our world today. And you might remember in the first four chapters of our study in 1 Corinthians all that time ago, I titled that entire study over four chapters, Undivided. Because as Paul approaches the Corinthian church, and his goal is still the same here in chapter 8 as it was back then, his goal is to seek to squash division. And oftentimes, the smarter we get, the more divisive we become. There are scholars in the fields of psychology, in physics, in philosophy, who would all seek to answer the same questions of what is the purpose of this life? And each and every one of them will give a wrong answer and a different answer than the others. Even the most smart people in different varying fields of study come to different conclusions, but they would claim that theirs is correct. Oftentimes, people on a religious level, all sorts of people will argue, claiming to have knowledge from a divine source, having differing divisive knowledge. And even on the small scale, people with little knowledge about a topic claim to be experts. Have you not been on Facebook lately? Knowledge can oftentimes, when it puffs us up, divide. It's a dangerous thing sometimes. It's one thing to know, on the one hand, how to fire a gun. It's one thing to know how to clean that gun. It's one thing to know how to load that gun. But if you lack the human respect or the respect for that weapon, you can get yourself into a lot of trouble real quick. Knowledge can be a dangerous thing if love is not there with it. And likewise, Paul recognizes the danger of a little bit of knowledge when he says in verse 1, knowledge puffeth up. Literally, the Greek word here means to get a big head. Your knowledge brings you to a point where you are thinking that you know everything. And those who have been puffed up by knowledge not only have a big head, but most often they'll have blinders on their eyes where they can't see all the areas in which they're wrong. There are people who have little knowledge here in the Corinthian church about the sacrifice to idols and what the Bible says about idols, and therefore they think that they know it all. Whereas those who also have great knowledge and understand everything that the Bible says on it have the same blinders on and won't talk to the other group. And so division is happening here in the church at Corinth. And church, the same thing is true for us today. It's not about should we eat meat sacrificed to idols. Many of us are not going to come into contact with such a dilemma in our life. Most of what Paul says in chapter 8 seems very outside of the world that we live in today. But the reality of the truths of what Paul is talking about here is true in principle in the world that we live in. Many of us have a little bit of knowledge when it comes to some biblical commands, ideas, and themes. And I spoke just recently to someone, and I said, you know, as someone who became a minister very early on in my life, God was calling me to stand before adults who had been in church longer than I had been alive and teach them something new. And you might get your feelings hurt. You might get your toes stepped on. I don't know how you're going to respond to what I'm about to say, but the very first thing I realized as, I will admit, at 19 years old, as a very immature Christian, as a young person who was coming up into the ministry, I was doing what God called me to do. I said, Lord, how can I ever speak to people who know more than me? And it became evident in the American church that is here and across our country that oftentimes we have a surface level of biblical values and nothing more. Many of us have not gone any further in our knowledge. And I wonder if it's not what Paul is telling us here, that we've got puffed up by just a little bit of knowledge, and we think we know it all. We think no one can tell us anything. And I am so thankful for a church that age has never been an issue in my ministry, that whatever I'm preaching to you by the Spirit of God, you receive willingly. I don't think we are a church that says, no, I'm not ready to learn anything new. But to a degree or another, we all find ourselves at one point or another saying, maybe I don't need any more study. Maybe I don't need any more depth in my knowledge of the Lord. Because the reality is, if we're honest with ourselves, everyone in this room would have to agree, myself included, at one time or another, we haven't read our Bible like we should. We have not been as hungry for the Word of God as we should, that we would come on a Sunday morning and we would say amen to a pastor and we'd be engaged with the pastor and we would want to know more. And Brother Taylor, I can't wait for you to finish the book of Genesis because I'm so excited to see what the end of it holds. Read it yourself. I have more to add to it, but individually, are we reading our Bibles? Knowledge puffeth up. Many times I think that the reason we don't do these things is because, whether or not we like to admit it, we have told God, at least by our actions, Lord, I know enough. I don't need any more. I'm going to heaven, ain't I? Lord, I don't need any more. We haven't studied individually or corporately like we should. You know, I am so glad that our Sunday evenings and our Wednesday nights are continuing to grow, that there are actually people who show up for those services. I don't know if you recognize this because you go to this church and not another church, but Sunday evening service is out the window in many churches. And the reason is not because the pastoral staff and the deacon body and even the church don't recognize that it's important. The reality is no one's showing up. And I'm glad we have a church that is showing up. But I have to say, this crowd that's here this morning is not always the same crowd. It's definitely never the same in numbers as it is on Sunday evening and as it is on Wednesday night. And the question has to become, well, why not? Have we learned enough here? Or have we learned enough individually at home in our study? Do we not need anything more? And the danger in that, guys, because I say it every Sunday, there's a group of people outside these walls, there are worldly individuals outside of these walls who would say, I don't need to go to church because I can do it by myself. That's the main argument from the world is, why do I need to go to church? That preacher ain't going to tell me nothing. I can't read in the Bible myself. Yes, he can. And not just me. You can. Sunday school is so important because you're getting a different perspective on this passage. What has the Lord said to the person sitting across from you? How has this verse come true in someone's life that you may not have ever seen in your own? This fellowship of believers is important. And Hebrews chapter 10 tells us it's not only important, but it's all the more important as the day draws near. What day? The day of Christ's return. He is coming on the clouds. We are all going to stand before him in judgment. And he says that this is going to be important as the day draws near. We don't need more study. We don't need to be more prepared. We don't need to gather together more often. I was so encouraged. I'm very organized. I'm a person who, like, I don't like things jumped on me. You know, but when Carolyn and Ricky told me, they said, hey, some people have approached us and said that they want to get together and they want to have a Good Friday prayer service at the church. I am glad that people in the church want to gather together, not just to have events, not just to have fun, but to worship the Lord and to pay homage to him and to say, I see what you've done. I recognize this Good Friday because you died on the cross. That's what we need more of, is people recognizing, I don't know it all. I need more study. The reality is, most of us in this room, I would be willing to bet if we raised our hands right now, even my hand would go up. Who understands the book of Leviticus? Don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. You know, none of us are going to raise our hand for who understands the book of Leviticus. But if I said for the next year, all we're studying on Sunday morning, Sunday evening, Wednesday night is the book of Leviticus, our numbers would decrease. We wouldn't have as many people who were showing up for church. You know why? Because we don't want to learn about the book of Leviticus. We don't care what the Lord has for us in that book. We don't. And it all goes back to knowledge puffeth up. I think I know too much. We're not willing to say it to the Lord, but the reality is we're not ready to engage with him in a full level of his knowledge. Instead of trying to fully understand God, we grab a little bit of knowledge here, a little bit of knowledge there, and then we get on Facebook, we go out there to the world, and we speak for God. And we don't have it all ourselves. I'm not saying you can't speak to the world around you unless you've read this Bible back to front. But what I am saying is we should not be stale Christians who are not ready to engage with him more fully. And I can speak confidently, as you ought to as well, that there is one God. That Christ has stepped down from heaven, that he has given his life for you and for me, and that all who call on his name will be saved. Those are truths that I can say, whether I've read little of this book or all of this book. But the reality is, we have to go further than this. There are other truths of our faith that are much more complicated to nail down in Scripture. And it is not stuff that we can just flippantly read through our Bible or not read through it at all. But it requires a gathering of believers. It requires intense study, and most of all, it requires humbling ourselves and recognizing, I don't know it all. I need help from only the Holy Spirit who can guide me in understanding this word. And I think it's on purpose that this Bible is complicated. Namely, because in verse 1 of 1 Corinthians chapter 8, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. We can know everything there is to know, but if we don't love people while we do it, we know nothing at all. And you've got a preacher who I feel confident in the way that people have approached me and told me, phew, that one stung this morning, that I stand up here and I try not to sugarcoat. I try to tell you the whole truth. I try to step on sins. I try to step on toes. I try to do that. But one thing you will never see me do from the pulpit is I'm never going to call a name and say, I'm going to call your name now because you're in my, I know I like to step on your toes anyway. Sister Carolyn sins, and I'm going to name them right here, right now. I'm not going to do that. Why? It might be true that she is some grave sinner. Man, you just in it today. I'm so sorry. I'm glad I picked good. She's smiling about it. It might be true that Sister Carolyn is some grave sinner. But you know what? If I list her sins before the congregation, as true as that might be, that's not loving. That's not the way you do things. And many of us, we are so literal in our Bible, and it's good, until the truth is not given in love. You can't win the people to Christ if you beat them down with their sins and never tell them of the truth of the love of Christ. We can go overboard on that side too, but it has to be done in love. You can't approach a brother or a sister who you have no relationship with and say, hey, I saw this sin in your life. I need you to fix it. They're not coming back to church ever again, and you're not ever going to hear from them again, and they're probably going to fall in their love to the Lord. Why? Because you have to have a relationship with them. You have to do it in love. And I say it, and we've talked about church a lot this morning, and I talk about it every Sunday, but that's the purpose of this gathering. This purpose is not we have a bunch of seats so that people can listen to one person. This is a relationship. This is why we eat so often. And because I like my food. This is why we gather together and do other things. Why? Because part of being a church is the fellowship among believers, of developing these relationships, of loving one another. Charity edifieth. You can't have the truth without love. Love is greater than knowledge. Love covers over a multitude of sins. Let your life be one that's governed by love. And if you have a problem with that, is that not how Christ lived? The truth of Christ is that he is God before time. Is that he stepped down from heaven to this humble abode. And throughout Christ's ministry, wasn't he approached every single day and asked, who are you? And he would tell them the truth of the things, but when the test came and they placed him on that cross, they said, call down some angels if you're really God. If you're really God and you've saved others, won't you save yourself? And in that moment, between truth and love, God did not choose truth, that he would call down angels from heaven to get him off of that cross. He did not choose truth, that he would trample all of these Roman soldiers and all these Jewish leaders who were calling him a liar and go into some mad rage right there. Why? Because the love in that moment to suffer and die for you and me greatly outweighs the momentary truth that Christ is going to look like. He's dead, that he's failed, that Satan wins. The reality is, sometimes love conquers truth. And when we find that fact, the reality is, when we love others, the truth will come out in the meantime. The truth will always be prevalent and prevail. He could have finished his ministry by revealing the truth of the matter, but Christ finished his ministry with love. And Paul goes on to not only tell us that love is better than knowledge, but that knowledge can also be deceptive. Look with me at verse 2. And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know. When I got the phone call that very first year teaching that I would be teaching fifth grade math, I walked into the classroom, and I walked in the day before school started. I didn't have a poster hanging on the wall. And anybody who's listening who on Facebook who might be from my school is going to say, you still don't have posters on your wall. It's because I'm not that kind of teacher. You know, I'm the male amongst all the ladies, and you don't want me to design no frou-frou room because it's going to be ugly. Anyway, I didn't have – I wasn't prepared. I came in. I said, I've done fifth grade a long time ago. I mean, I'm a college graduate. How bad can fifth grade math be? And, y'all, I got in, and the very first standard, and, I mean, this might tell you something about Common Core, but here's what I had to teach. My fifth grade standard for place value, the very first one, students will identify that a number to the left is 10 times greater than the number to the right, and a number to the right on the place value chart is 1/10 of the numbers to the left. Yep, I see your eyes going. Me too. I had to read it 500 times. And I got up there in front of them kids, and they started throwing spitballs and everything else in the world because I couldn't engage them because I had no idea what I was teaching. I learned something new. And I was like, wait a minute. You're telling me this place value chart is just multiplying by 10? I learned something. I thought I knew everything fifth grade had to offer. And the sad part is, it might be sad to you, but you try fifth grade math, you try whatever math. Every year, I learn a little bit more. I learn something that I took for granted before. I find another way to explain something that's a little bit easier. I approach it differently. Things that I knew a lot of, things I thought I knew everything about, turns out I didn't know nothing. And it took me going in-depth in studying fifth grade math in order to be able to replicate that and to give that to my students. And Paul is saying the same thing here as it comes to us as knowledgeable Christians. He says in verse 2, if we think we know anything, we don't know nothing. The pride of knowledge is that we think we know it all. And the reality is, we have to be constant students of the truth. This fellowship is important for a reason. And people ask me all the time, and here's where I want to encourage constant student of the Bible, claiming I know nothing about the Bible. People ask me all the time, have you read the entire Bible? And me and Kyle had a conversation about this just last Sunday evening, and I don't know how it even came up, but we basically came to the same conclusion that through his private Christian education as in high school, through Carrie, through my education, I have probably read, bits and pieces all put together, the whole Bible. But I count that as nothing. Because atheists can go, and I said this when we did 1 Corinthians chapter 1, go back and listen to the video of the sermon. There's atheists out there, I've read the Bible 5 times, 7 times, 10 times, and they don't believe that Jesus is the Christ. They don't believe he's God. You ain't read good. You can read the Bible from cover to cover, and at the end of it, it will be an accomplishment, but it will not be an accomplishment that you set it on the shelf and you never pick it up again. The Bible is a book that every time you read the passages that you've read 1,000 times before, that you were taught in Sunday school, those pages that you relish and you thought you could tell me the story of Noah front to back, you're going to say, wait a minute. There was a few more animals than that on the ark. Wait a minute. These ones didn't get on? This is what he did with the unclean versus the clean animals? Every time you study it, there's more gems and jewels in Scripture. And that's why, here's a shameless plug, my Genesis study on Sunday evenings. I encourage people to come because we're looking at stories you think you know. Knowledge puffeth up. But when you look at it again, you recognize, wait a minute, I didn't know nothing. That I was told in Sunday school is the story, but look at the glorious truths that it reveals about Christ as we dive in. This Bible is not something we can study one time and be done with. It is something we have to be diving into and grappling with each and every day, no matter how many times we've looked at it. Yet there are those who have little knowledge and would claim to know it all. And to the one who says he knows it all, Paul says, you know nothing. And I don't know what can be a more powerful response or garner greater respect than the fool who claims to know but does not. Church, let's collectively humble ourselves and recognize when it comes to this Bible, when it comes to God's Word, I believe the truths of Christ, that he has come and he has died for me, that this is the central theme of the message. But outside of that, I want to be a fool. I want to know nothing. I want to hunger and thirst for this word, that he would fill me up, that he would give me greater knowledge, because I recognize that he who is before time began, he who is almighty, he who is all-knowing, he who is omniscient, all of these things, he has something to teach me. Compared to him, compared to his word, I know nothing at all. And with that affirmation, let's collectively covenant to seek after him and to know him better ourselves. Because if you're going to grow in him, it's going to take covenanting together as a church and saying, I'm going to go home and in my house, I'm going to open up the Bible with my family. With my children, I'm going to open up the Bible. With my grandchildren, I'm going to open up the Bible. I'm going to gather around not only the dinner table, but I'm going to gather with my family and I'm going to come before the Lord in prayer and seeking after him. I'm going to take time in the mornings, in the evenings, whenever I have free time, and I'm going to fill it with the things of the Lord. And it doesn't matter if I comprehend 100% of it, or if it is just, I've told some people that have talked to me about how they should read the Bible, I say one of the ways I do it, I fill time, is I have a 45-minute commute. To and then 45 minutes back from work. Let the Bible be read over your speakers in your car. You might not get all of it, but there is something different about that dead time, not being filled with the filthiness of this world, not being filled with just mindless thought, but being filled with God's word playing over you. There's something different about that. Fill your time with the word of God. That's what it's going to take if we're going to covenant together and say, I know nothing and I want to know you better, Lord. It's going to take us coming on Wednesday night. It's going to take us coming on Sunday evening. It's going to take us saying, that Sunday school teacher, I might know more than he or she does. I don't know. That might be why you don't go. You might say, it's because, well, I got to get dressed for Sunday school, and that's an hour earlier. It's going to take us saying, whatever our problem is with Sunday school, I've got something to learn. Are we willing as a church to lay down our pride, to humble ourselves, to grow in him by hungering for him and his knowledge? If we are, we have to make a decision to do so. But there are many who don't have, even after all of this, that hunger for the knowledge of the Lord. There are many who are content with the little knowledge they have. And yet Paul tells us this is a sign of a true believer. Verse 3. If any man love God, the same is known of him. A love of God leads to knowledge of God. You ought not to be in the same place you were spiritually a year ago, months ago, years ago. But I wonder if you were to take a spiritual inventory of your life, would you be growing towards the Lord and the knowledge of the Lord? Or would you be in the same place? Or would you be backsliding from the place that you once were? We ought not to be doing that. You ought to have a hunger for God's word. You ought to have a desire for a fellowship of like-minded individuals. And it all comes from loving God. It's a prerequisite for it all. Do you still have the love for the one who saved you? Do you still have love for the one who would set everything aside in heaven and step down to live under the law that he gave? Do you still have the love for the one who, even being obedient to the law, would go so far as to die on the sinner's cross for you? Do you still have love for the one who you called out to so many years ago and made him the savior of your life? Do you still have love? If you still have love, then the fruit of it is you ought to be seeking him and the knowledge of him. You can know that you have love for God if you're seeking after him. Because the verse does not only suggest that we seek after the knowledge of God, but look at the verb here in verse 3. If any man love God, the same is known of him. The reality is God is so close to you that to seek after him is not some grand ordeal. You are loved by him first, and all you have to do is turn to him in true obedience and seek after him, and the rest will fall into place. If you will truly seek to know the Lord better, if you will truly just put one foot in front of the other and do the little things that you know you ought to do but have been not doing for so long, the rest will fall into place. If you will turn and try to seek the Lord, you will recognize that the Lord is earnestly seeking after you. You are known by him and loved by him. Those who love God will also be sought by the Father. Even in the times when you don't have that hunger and that thirst for the word of God, the Lord is still there in the midst of it all. And greater than any worldly knowledge is the truth that all we have to do to love the Lord is to be known by him, is to turn and to seek after him. And so this morning, as we talk a lot about knowledge, I wonder how knowledgeable would you claim to be at the end of all of this? I hope that you, like I, would say, I am a fool, if nothing else, before Jesus Christ, and that I daily want to seek after him more. And this morning, your invitation can be one that's from your seat, where you say, hey, I have backslidden to some degree in my life in that I need to come and partake in Sunday school. We have plenty of Sunday school classes that are ready to engage and to go deeper in fellowship together. Hey, I need to see what's going on as many Sunday nights as I can, as many Wednesday nights as I can. Why? Because I want to seek after the Lord. I want to grow in knowledge of him. This morning, your invitation, if you're not a member, might be to say, am I a member of a church? If not, maybe this is the place where I covenant together with these believers and seek after the Lord together. And this morning, if you're someone who has never accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord of your life, maybe today the recognition is He has loved me first, and in response to that, I want to know Him for all of my life and for all of eternity. Maybe this morning, your decision is to come before Him and ask Him to be the Lord of your life. I'd love to help you through any of those decisions this morning. As we stand together, would you stand with me as we sing this hymn of invitation, Only Trust Him.
Thank you for joining us online today. Remember, you can find additional videos at these online locations. If you would like to give, you can mail your offering to First Baptist Church Brooklyn at P.O. Box 340 in Brooklyn, Mississippi 39425. If you would like to talk to someone, you can call our church number or you can visit us for one of our in-person worship times. We hope to see you soon.